Wendy Natter, and I'm serving as an education intern this summer at the Provincetown Art Association and Museum. It's my pleasure to welcome you to tonight's Freddie Schiff Levin Lecture, Perspectives on the Provincetown Art Colony, with author Deborah Forman. The lecture will be followed by a book signing. We hope you'll also join us for the next Freddie Schiff Levin Gallery Talk at PAM at 7 p.m. on Tuesday, July 19, with the artist Bernd Hofmann, in conjunction with his exhibition at PAM, Subjective Environments. This lecture series was begun in 2003 in honor of the artist Freddie Schiff Levin, who was a member of Provincetown's arts community from the 1960s until her passing in 2002. PAM gratefully acknowledges John and Tony Levin and Herbert Lee, who make this program possible with their generous support. We would also like to thank Angel Foods for their continued support and for another fabulous cheese platter. Please help yourself to refreshments and visit Angel Foods, located directly across the street. And now I'd like to introduce you to the author, Deborah Forman. Deborah Forman has been covering the artist colony in Provincetown for 30 years. She has interviewed dozens of artists and writers for articles she's written for the Cape Cod Times, Cape Cod View Magazine, Art New England, and Boston Magazine. These interviews are at the core of her book, Perspectives on the Provincetown Art Colony, which begins with the launching of the artist colony in 1899 when Charles Hawthorne opened his Cape Cod School of Art, and continues into the 21st century. Among those artists she's interviewed are Robert Motherwell, Jack Twerkov, Red Grooms, Raphael Sawyer, Chaim Gross, Myron Stout, Fritz Bultmann, Paul Resica, Sidney Simon, John Grillo, Lee Manzo, Michael Mazur, Helen Frankenthaler, Paul Bowen, Varujan Bogosian, Sal Dedeo, really, really taxing me today, Tony Vivers, Ann Packard, Selena Treif, Robert Henry, and numerous other people with hard to pronounce names. Writers included are Norman Mailer, Gore Vidal, Saul Bellow, and Michael Cunningham. In addition to her discussion with artists and writers, she has talked to directors of art galleries and museums, and their stories are included in this book. Deborah was the features editor of the Cape Cod Times and editor-in-chief of Cape Cod View magazine. She wrote the script, conducted the interviews, and worked on the filming for Arts in Its Soul, an award-winning documentary of the history of the Provincetown Art Colony, which was aired on Boston's public television station WGBH and subsequently on public television stations nationwide. She has a degree in journalism from Temple University in Philadelphia and has studied art at the Pennsylvania Academy of Fine Arts and at the Philadelphia Museum School of Art. Deborah and her husband live in Cape Cod, not far from the Provincetown Artist Colony. We are thrilled to be able to celebrate Deborah and the publication of Perspectives on the Provincetown Art Colony, published by Schiffer this summer. The beautiful two-volume set is available for sale tonight, and if we run out before you're able to purchase the set, Debbie has graciously offered to sign a copy ordered for you by the PAM bookstore. Please help me welcome Deborah Forman.
Thank you, Wendy, and thank you everybody for coming. Perspectives on the Provincetown Art Colony. So, the perspective is provided primarily in the book by the artists that I interviewed, and as Wendy said, there were dozens. Actually, probably there are about 70 interviews in the book. There are probably about 200 artists included, which of course is only a small fraction of the number of artists that were in the art colony in the last 100 and some years. However, when I was working on the book early on, one of the editors that I was working with said, you know, this book is getting to be encyclopedic. You know, you want to tell a story. You want it to be engaging, and if we want an encyclopedia, that's one thing, but this should be a story. So therefore, my apologies to the artists who are not included, but I hope that the story that it tells in the book and a little bit of what I'm going to tell you here will give you a sense of the importance of the Provincetown Art Colony. As Wendy said, it goes back to, we go back to 1899 when Charles Hawthorne opened up his Cape Cod School of Art. I couldn't get back there, and of course, when I did the research for the book, I was able to fill in. But when I did the film, which Wendy mentioned, Art and Its Salt, I was able to interview a woman who had studied with him when she was just a girl. She studied with Hawthorne in 1926, Marge Halper. Her husband, she was Marjorie Windust in 1926. She later married Nat Halper, who had was a Joyce scholar and had the HCE Gallery in Provincetown in the 50s and early 60s. So the story starts with Charles Hawthorne. And many of us have seen this wonderful painting of Hawthorne's, which is a typically traditional painting for that era. That painting is now hanging at the Cape Cod Museum of Art, where there's an exhibition related to the book. But many of the works that you're going to see here on the PowerPoint, as well as in the book, are in the collection of the Provincetown Art Association, and they've been great to Jim Zimmerman and Chris, and everybody involved here has been wonderful in providing images for the book and also for loaning pieces for the exhibition in Dennis. Charles Hawthorne, according to Marge Halper, who, when she studied with him, described what a wonderful person he was, she described him as charismatic. He would arrive on the beach or the pier where he would be doing a demonstration in his white flannels and a white shirt. And you're going to see a photograph later on, also from the archives here, of how the women and men were dressed, also beautifully, as if they were going to a party. And she would describe how he was doing a demonstration. And I'll never forget, she said, he could draw a profile just like that, and it was, you know, in minutes, he had this beautiful image. She said he was a god to us. She described him also as he came to a costume party at the right here at the Provincetown Art Association in the early days, dressed as Caesar, which she thought was very in keeping with his personality. And and you'll see a progression with a few of these, kind of an impressionistic approach, and you can certainly see that in Girl Sewing. And his late watercolors really express how he taught. He taught, don't draw, he said, create form by using one spot of color against another. And you really can see this in these beautiful, very loose watercolors that he did. And that was his approach. And here's a wonderful photograph. And you could see Hawthorne there in his white. And there's the monument behind him. There were a number of painting schools in the early years of the 20th century. A. Ambrose Webster had a school. He was one of the kind of early modernists. You can see kind of the Fauvist influence there in his colors. George Elmer Brown had a school. The conservative faction, it was kind of interesting because if we think about the time, you know, a very famous artist, William Paxton, was there, and you can see traditional kind of art. Again, R.H. Ives Gamel, academic piece, but very strong. That's in the exhibition in Dennis. Max Bohm, also the grandfather of Ann Packard. He was involved in the art colony early on. So that was the traditional John Wharf, beautiful watercolors, very loose. However, in Provincetown, the Art Association was established in 1914, and there was, beginning in the 20s, there was a conflict because there was a sense of modernism coming into town, and yet there were these traditionalists who were holding on. And at one point, they had to the people in the modern camps encouraged the jury, who were mostly conservatives, to split the show. So they had two shows every year, one where they had a modern jury and one where they had a conservative jury. One of the earlier modernists who really lobbied for a more modern approach was Edwin Dickinson, very active in the art colony, as was Ross Moffat. He wrote Art in Narrow Streets and talked a lot about the early years, which were sounded very romantic. And actually, he was a good source for me for the research of the early years. But you can see some of the modernism creeping in, and certainly this one has a cubist. His skies were always those swirling skies, as you can see there and there. Very typical of what Moffat did. Here are some of the other early modernists moving into kind of a more contemporary approach. Karl Kanass, that pretty much borders on abstract. Oliver Chafee. Marston Hartley was here. He was here along with Charles DeMuth, and they were here at the time. They were involved with the Provincetown Players, who formed in 1915, and they did plays on a wharf in Provincetown. And Charles DeMuth and Marston Hartley worked and did some of the art and the posters for the Provincetown Players. In 1916, Eugene O'Neill came, a young, brooding playwright, and his first play, Bound East for Cardiff, was produced on a wharf in Provincetown in 1916. The Provincetown was always a welcoming place beside what attracted the artists, the light and the kind of charm of this little fishing village was also the freedom that they felt. They didn't feel, the Portuguese population was very welcoming and very open, and there was a sense, an atmosphere of freedom that was established pretty early on. And so a lot of the anti-establishment, the Bohemians, a lot of the Greenwich Village people came here in those early years. Also, in around this time, you had the Provincetown Printers. Many of them, it was a large group, many of them, or most of them were women, and many of them had studied in Paris prior to World War I. And they were introduced to Cubism and Fauvism, and they really had a sense of what was happening, which was very different from what was happening in here. If we remember, 1913 was the New York Armory Show, which introduced the American public to modern art as it was happening in Europe, but certainly very little of it was seen in this country. And some artists began to latch on to some of these trends. The Provincetown Printers, once World War I broke out, they came, Hawthorne had been to Paris and had talked up Provincetown as this really terrific place. So many of them came to Provincetown, and they worked in prints, woodblock prints, and B.J. O'Nordfelt developed what we now know as the white line woodcut, as you can see, and he decided, he thought the traditional Japanese method of using a single block, each block for a different color, was a little tedious, so he came up with the idea of being able to create one wood block with all the color, and he managed to separate the colors with these deep gouges, which is your white line. And many of the, Ethel Morris was part of the Provincetown Printers, as was Ellen Ravenscroft, and I noticed that her print is in the other room. And again, you have a real good sense in that work of her, of the white line. Blanche Lazelle is probably today the most famous of that group. Her work pretty much bore, many of the Provincetown printers were very interested in fauvist colors, but Blanche Lozelle kind of latched onto cubism, and this is a wonderful painting that's in the collection of this museum here, and actually is hanging in the Dennis show this year. Agnes Weinrich was another member of the Provincetown printers, and also she and Blanche Lozelle kind of ventured into cubism. And this is another, and I think there's a piece somewhere hanging of Farrell Sibley Worth, I think in the front room. Again, you see the white line woodcut. Hawthorne died in 1930. Henry Henschey was his assistant. And a few years later, he opened up his Cape School of Art. Henry taught basically an impressionistic approach to art. And the Mudheads was the name given for the fact that when he posed the, as Hawthorne did, when he posed his subjects in light, the light kind of blurred their faces. And I remember Marge Halper saying that when Hawthorne taught her, taught his class, he said, "I don't really care if you make cauliflower ears or no ears at all. The whole idea was putting one spot of color against another." So here you see that in with Henschey. Now, these are a few of the students of Henry Henschey. Robert Douglas Hunter, and this is very typical of Bob Hunter's work. It's he's best known for his still lifes. And it's kind of interesting, as we go on, I'm moving into the area where I actually interviewed some of these artists. And so what I have done, I taped all my interviews. So therefore, I have a lot of good quotes that I want to share with you, because I think it really brings to life how the artists felt, their insights. Bob, who studied briefly with Henschey and then went on to study with R.H. Ives Gamel, he talked about, believe it or not, the abstract elements that he looked for in a work of art. And he said some things that I thought were pretty interesting. He said, which relates a little later to some of the way Hofmann taught, but he said, "You don't paint a section at a time, but you try to paint by seeing the whole thing." He said one aspect of a painting is contingent on the rest. And he talked about the unity of effect, so that you're not just painting the vase, or you're always working the whole canvas or the whole paper. And he thought that was really important. Hilda Neely, who has still painting in town and has a gallery, very much followed in the impressionistic mode, as you can see. She said the most important thing that Henschey taught her was how to keep learning to see color and put it down. And Henschey certainly was all about color. Sal Daldeo, also a student of Henschey, and he talked about several of the students that talked to me about Henschey's teaching said that he was rather autocratic. It was just, he wanted you to paint his way. Sal, who had a lot of, very positive things about Henschey, and said that there were things that Henschey taught him that he remembered to this day. He also said he felt it was important to nurture a student. As if you were, nurturing a plant. That's how important, to give it love and warmth and affection. And I had a sense that he was also saying that it was not exactly what Henschey did. This is a painting by Henschey, very typical of his impressionistic style. It's a portrait of Christopher Hyland. Christopher Hyland was about 20 years old, and I think this was painted in 1968. And he lived on the North Shore with his parents, and his parents wanted him to wanted a portrait done in the impressionistic style. So they came to Henschey, and Christopher came and spent about 2 weeks in Provincetown. And if you think about what 1968 must have been like in Provincetown, with the hippies and the beads and the you know, the jeans and whatever. And here you have Christopher posing in this three-piece white suit, which reflects all the light, which is really quite beautiful. And he talked about Henschy, and he said that, you know, he called Henschy persnickety, but he said they got along pretty well. He said, "I was hell-bent," he said, "on the portrait being a great impressionist painting." He said, "But when it was done, my mother didn't like it at all." Although it was his parents that really wanted to. His parents were a neighbor of Frank Benson's brother, and so that's where they got the idea of this impressionistic style of painting. Here's another Sal Del Deo, which gives you a sense of what he's painting today. Chaim Gross said Hans Hofmann, and Chaim Gross was a representational painter, he said Hans Hofmann changed the whole picture of Provincetown and probably changed the whole picture of art in America. He was a native of Germany. Here he is painting. A native of Germany. He was in Paris prior to World War I. Became in touch with the Cubists, the Fauvists, and then right before the war broke out, he went back to Germany. And then he couldn't get back to Paris because the war broke out and Germany and France were at war. So he had a school in Germany, in Munich, and he taught, and he had a lot of American students coming there. And one of his American students was at Berkeley, a teacher at Berkeley, art teacher, and in 1930, he invited Hofmann to come and teach at Berkeley. So Hofmann left Germany in 1930, which was probably good because the Nazis would have considered his art, probably burned it. And this is some of Hofmann's art, and we're gonna, I never met Hofmann, but I talked to a number of his students. Selena and Bob are here, and we talked a long time about Hofmann, and I'm gonna give you some interesting insights into Hofmann from the students' point of view. These are some of his works. He was primarily a teacher until he taught in Province. After he was at Berkeley, he came to New York and he taught at the Art Students League, and then he opened up his school in, I think, 1935 in New York and also in Provincetown. And he ran the school for 23 years in Provincetown in the summers, and he attracted thousands and thousands of students, many of whom are household names today. And he was apparently a marvelous teacher. The first student of Hofmann's I spoke to was Fritz Bultmann. And Fritz had a very special relationship with Hofmann. He really considered Hofmann like a father to him. And some of the things he said were pretty interesting. He said, "What I learned most from Hofmann was how to see, how to live, and a real sense of values." And you're going to hear some more of what people, what students said. Bultmann also remembered Hofmann had this old Packard car, and he would pile in his easel and paints and canvases, and he'd go into Truro, into the hills, and paint. And most of his work was pretty loose and, you know, probably bordering on the abstract. But Bultmann said he was so able to capture the essence of the location that Bultmann could actually identify where he had painted. And yet the painting was virtually abstract, but that was the skill that he talked about. Myron Stout, what you're going to see when you see some of the work of some of the students is how diverse they were, and that is a credit to the way probably Hofmann taught. Myron Stout had a lot. I interviewed Myron Stout several times, and he had a lot of insight into the details of the way Hofmann taught. He said He knew where you were to start with better than you knew it. Instead of pouring it in, he drew it out of you. It was like learning something from the inside rather than the outside. He said he had a marvelous personal insight as well as a wide body of knowledge, and he could tell where the person was as an artist and as a human being and knew how to approach that student. He didn't set up one way to do something. He set up some principles and he let the student find out for himself. He emphasized that no matter how abstract you got, there was always a connection between abstract and nature. He also talked about the famous push and pull of Hofmann. And Myron Stout explained it this way. He said, he held up his hands. He said, think about a blown up balloon. If you push it here, there's going to be a reaction over there. So there are these dynamics that you really need to consider, and that was how Stout explained push-pull. We'll go on, and as we go on, you'll see how different some of the students work. Here is something by Selena and Bob Henry, and they are married and been married for many years, and yet their work, as you can see, is very different. Bob Henry said he taught structure in a way that promoted whatever his students wanted to do. And then Selena chimed in and she said, he loved his students. And then Bob said, he loved art. Financial success was not the goal. It was truly all about art. John Grillo, whose work is here, after he came out of after World War II, he came out of the Navy and was in San Francisco, and he kind of got involved with abstract expressionism at that point. And his work is in that gallery, in this gallery. Some of his early work, which would have been when he was in San Francisco. This is one of the series of his, he did tango and circus, did a lot of themes. And this is a woodcut that is really pretty dramatic. John Grillo said that he was in San Francisco, came east, realized that that's kind of where all the action was, came to New York, and he said Hofmann confirmed his adulation of vivid color. And as you can see, if you look at some of the work here, you can see what Grillo's love of color. He said Hofmann made me conscious about certain elements of creativity, and he said Hofmann was very kind to introduce him to the city circle of the New York City circle of abstractionists. And Grillo studied with Hofmann both here and in New York. Sam Feinstein, another student of Hofmann, he taught classes for many years pretty much in the style, in Dennis, where he lived, pretty much in the style of the way Hofmann taught. I actually sat in on a couple of his classes, which gave me a sense of what Hofmann did. One of the things he would do is set up a still life that could be as long as this wall, and it was just full of vases and crockery and drapes. And then he would have his students look at a section or the whole thing and be inspired to do something. And Sam was mostly, although early on he did figurative work, he pretty much became an abstractionist, probably abstract expressionist. Abstract expressionism in Provincetown was pretty important. The first generation of abstract expressionists, every single one of them was here at one time or another. Motherwell, for the most, for the longest period of time, but even Jackson Pollock was here, William de Kooning was here, Klein, Rothko, every single one of them of that first generation was here at some time or another. Motherwell putting down the deepest roots. He first came here in the 40s, but then came back in the 50s, and his house was on Commercial Street. Actually, Robert Motherwell was the first artist that I ever interviewed in Provincetown, and I think I got hooked then. He was having a show at Long Point Gallery. It was 1979, and I was relatively new to the Cape and relatively new to the newspaper, and of course I had known about Robert Motherwell for a long time and saw, oh my goodness, he's in Provincetown, maybe I can interview him. So I called the director of the gallery and she said, well, let me see what I can do. And I kind of didn't expect that I would ever get the interview, but she called me back and said that you can come at such and such a date, and there I arrived. And I'm not sure if he thought I was the New York Times and not the Cape Cod Times. But anyway, I arrived and he was on the phone, and the door was open and he said, come on in, and he finished his phone conversation. And it was a really hot August day. And we moved out to the porch and then out to the deck. And he was kind of reserved to begin with, but we kind of got to talking, and he realized that I was a great admirer of his, and so he opened up, and we talked for probably an hour or more at least. He was very articulate, was probably the chief spokesman of the abstract expressionist movement, and he said he was eminently quotable. So let me just give you a couple of his quotes that are just so, you know, I'm just so really impressed with what he had to say. He talked about voyeurs. All artists, he said, are voyeurs. He said they live off the eye. And he talked about, he had been in Paris and the cafes in Paris, and how the French aren't likely to invite you to their house unless you're a member of the family or unless you're a really good friend. So if you want to get together, you go to one of the cafes and you watch the passing parade. And he said, you know, talking about all artists being voyeurs, he said, they live off the eye. In fact, one of the things I like, right, this is Motherwell talking, I like right here is the tidal flat. At low tide, it goes out about 900 feet, and people are walking by all the time. So I have my own cafe right in the water. And he said, there's no place in the world or in America, as far as I know, where such a marvelous thing exists. So he truly loved Provincetown. He said that he, for a few years, he spent time in East Hampton, where Pollock was and de Kooning was, but, and I love this quote, I don't even have to read it because I know it so well. He said he felt the people in East Hampton looked at him as if he was a stock on the exchange, whereas in Provincetown, it was egalitarian. He was, you know, he could just go around and be who he was and not, you know, be a, quote, celebrity. He also said that, you know, he was saying, you know, abstract expression wasn't so easily accepted at first. Lots of people really wondered if it wasn't done by monkeys. And I think there was a film with Jackson Pollock where they talked about that, you know, could have. And here is some of Motherwell's collages. This one was one of his famous elegies. When I interviewed, after the article appeared in the Cape Cod Times, I had a call from Boston Magazine saying they were interested in an interview, a story about him. And they said, do you think you could arrange it? And I called Motherwell. He was in Greenwich, Connecticut, and he said yes. He, you know, again, I guess we hit it off fairly well. And so I went to Greenwich and spent a day with him in, and one of his studios was where we spent most of our time, was at least 100 feet that accommodated one of his elegies, which oftentimes are more than 100 feet. And he had a printmaking studio, and he had a collage studio, and he had a framing studio, and he occupied a carriage house of an estate. In Greenwich, Connecticut. There were several artists that talked about truth. Motherwell was the first one that I heard talk about truth. And this is a longish quote, but kind of listen to it because I think it's pretty interesting. He said, "You don't give a false mathematical equation because it's easier to understand if it's not true. The Einsteinian equation, to many people, is very difficult, but it would never have occurred to Einstein to put it in a way that people could understand, which would then be false. The truth about that particular aspect of reality requires a very complicated, difficult formula. And in that sense, any true artist is putting down the most accurate formula he can for what he perceives. And if people don't get it, that's so much the worse for them, and so much the worse for him if he wants to be popular. The truth is the truth, and you don't want to change it to make it more palatable or to reach more people." The last interview I had with him was in Greenwich, and one of the last things he said, which ended up being pretty poignant, he said, "I started in a hostile working environment," and we think about abstract expression, which was pretty explosive on the American scene in the 40s and the 50s. "I started out in a hostile working environment in which only a handful of people cared about what I did. If it reverts to that handful, that won't change my feelings about it. The older I get, the more I become aware that all reality is in flux. I'm an old man, mad about painting, and no matter what the world thinks, I will remain mad about painting, which is how I began and how I'll end." And he died in Provincetown in 1991, in a place he loved. Jack Tworkov, there was a show here last year of Jack Tworkov's work. He also talked about truth. I interviewed him in New York in 1982 when he was a show of his was about to open at the Guggenheim. I interviewed him in his 23rd Street apartment, and when he stood a certain way, he reminded me of Picasso a little bit. He was kind of a short, sturdy man, and there was just an angle. And he said other people thought so too, but he didn't think so. And he talked about truth again. He said, "Cézanne didn't make beautiful paintings, he made true paintings. By comparison, other painters have made beautiful paintings, but not true paintings. A true painting like Cézanne stays with you a long time, so there's beauty, but it's a different kind of beauty." And here's that's an early piece, obviously Provincetown. He went through a period of abstract expressionism, and then he advanced or went beyond abstract expressionism to this working on grids. And he felt at a certain point, he told me that abstract expressionism was too personal, was too emotive, and he wanted to present a more universal approach. And he worked in a grid in this kind of minimalism that he developed. Another person who talked about truth was Helen Frankenthaler. And she was married to Robert Motherwell and spent time in Provincetown when they were married. She was here in doing a lecture at Castle Hill, and I spoke to her, and she talked about her paintings, which are, I don't have a piece here, but her painting is the color field very loose, and a lot of people look at her paintings as if they're landscapes, but she contended that they were abstract. She said, but at the same time, there's a subject. And she said that the message of a painting is a sense of beauty and order and pleasure that makes you recognize and feel other bigger things that are wonderful in life. Paintings, she said, have their beautiful working order just as nature has. Paintings don't lie. They must stand as truth on their own projections of the artist. She was coming as a very young woman, was making pretty significant inroads into the scene in the 50s. And I asked her, okay, so she was one of the few women that was really working in this man's world. And I said to her, so what was it like? And she kind of looked at me. She said, well, I didn't think about it. It wasn't an issue. I don't feel that I was put down because I was a female or that I was loved because I was a female. And then she said it became a big issue, and that was in the 60s with feminism. And she said, and then I thought, oh, a woman. So now I'm aware of it, and I think it has been an issue. But ultimately, she said, it didn't make a difference to her. I just wanted to do my thing, which in the end is what everyone has to do. I don't have, there is actually a small Frankenthaler that was loaned to the, we got on loan from the Nerdler Gallery, which is in the exhibition in Dennis. And here are just some examples of some other abstract expressionists who were in Provincetown. William Basiosidis, early on, he died young. Abstract expressionism was so important because it was the first truly American art movement, and it relates to Provincetown because that first generation was here. So there was a real strong sense of the importance of Provincetown. And as we see, when we trace it through the 20th century, just about every art movement played out in Provincetown. And so if you can look at the art in Provincetown, you really see it as a microcosm of 20th century American art, just a little piece, which is why we think of Provincetown as so important. But, you know, abstract expressionism was reigning, but there were still these representational artists. And I mentioned Chaim Gross before, and there are some pieces of his outside the museum, and if you walk down the street, there is his famous tourists of the tall, kind of buxom woman and the rotund, short rotund man. I interviewed Chaim, first interviewed him in the 80s. He was 80 years old then. Still a very vigorous, muscular man, because he was also, beside the bronzes, he was also carving wood. And his work was representational, but of course expressive in many ways. And he had gone into bronzes, but his first love was carving that wood. And I got to know Chaim, would see him here, and then would sometimes visit him in New York at his LaGuardia place, home and studio. And he was, what I recognized in his art was this sense of joy that, whether it was his mother, and often he did this mother and child theme, or his circus performers or acrobats, there was always this joyful sense. So I said to him, so how come, you know, where are you, you know, where does this come from? And he said, well, he thought that it came from his Jewish Hasidic tradition, which he said emphasized the blissful worship of God. And then he hesitated and he said, ultimately, happiness comes from within. And he was a very, you know, not that expressive, but you could see the warmth and the generosity. And when he died, there was a memorial service here at the museum. And people came up and said, you know, eulogized him in, you know, as this generous, loving, warm. Sidney Simon said he was the first sculptor. Chaim was the first sculptor that encouraged Sidney Simon to be a sculptor, and not in an envious way, and helped him get patrons to, you know, to buy his art. That was the kind of person Chaim was. And Mervyn Jules said it best. I obviously covered the memorial service. He said of Chaim, he was the kind of human being you wished you could be yourself. He was a good friend of Raphael Sawyer, and I interviewed Raphael Sawyer once or twice at Chaim's house here. And Raphael really felt that he was outside, you know, because abstract expressionism was kind of so powerful a movement. But he recalled to me he remembered Edward Hopper, and we'll see some of Edward Hopper's work. Hopper was a very reserved or reclusive, shy, but he spent, I don't know, 30 seasons in Truro in his house. And so I included him in the book, although I never interviewed him, but I've written a lot about him and kind of got to know him. And Sawyer recalled that he and his wife had a party, and this probably goes way back, and Edward Hopper came and Edwin Dickinson came. And if you remember Edwin Dickinson from the guitar, and he said Edwin Dickinson came in bare feet. And he said, Edwin Dickinson said, "I came in the shoes God gave me." That was the kind of conversation I had with Sawyer, who's very sweet. But then he talked about these artists, and you could see that he was feeling very much outside of the mainstream and remembering these representational artists. And he said they were modest people, they were interesting people, they were great artists, but they weren't celebrities. They were accessible, they were intelligent, they were hard workers. And he said, you know, almost like with a catch in his voice, he said, "And I admire them. I miss them. I like them, you know," and I could almost feel like a tear coming down is when he talked about that. So here we have these conflicts between the Will Barnett. I did not interview him for the book, but actually I just interviewed him a couple of days ago. He's 100 years old. He's going to have an exhibition here. And he was in Provincetown in the 50s and 60s, and we had this wonderful telephone conversation. He's still as lively and as had talked a lot about his art, and so there is, and there'll be a show here of his works on paper, I think in August. Milton Avery, also in Provincetown. Edward Hopper. You can see that house, that it's still an inn on Bradford Street. People remember it, and that's Edward Hopper painted it in the 40s. And this is Cape Cod Evening. I was able to get that image for the book it's at the National Gallery of Art. And I figured I had to have Cape Cod Evening for the book. In the 50s, there was this burgeoning of new figurative art, and the Sun Gallery was opened by two people, Dominic and I should remember her name, but anyway, two young people opened up this gallery, and they people were showing at the gallery were Red Grooms, Klaus Oldenburg, a number of new expressionistic figurative artists. And I interviewed Red Grooms. This print is in the collection of the Cape Cod Museum of Art, and there is Red Grooms looking over Edward Hopper's shoulder painting the lighthouse. And Red Grooms did a whole series of kind of these caricatures type pieces on artists. Many of them are very, very funny. He was a Hofmann student briefly. He said, but the classes weren't for him. He said, "I liked very much the wildness, the sensuality, the explosion of paint of abstract expressionism. The slap and the dash," he said, "but I wanted to harness it to real life." And so he did. If you're familiar with his paintings, you could almost hear them. They're so noisy. And this is, you know, one of a series that's a little quieter. But some of his ones in Manhattan and Chicago that are very urban are just full of, he did these sculpto pictoramas that are, you know, three-dimensional. He was part of this Sun Gallery. As was Klaus Oldenburg and George McNeil, a number of them. In 1968, that was the year when things got a little crazy in Provincetown, and there was, it reflected again what was happening in the rest of the country, the Vietnam War, the explosiveness, and you know, all of these hippies came to town, and if they the only art they were probably interested in was graffiti. So there was a sense among the artists and the writers in town that the art, the integrity of the art colony was being diluted. So they came together and they established the Fine Arts Work Center, which was there to revitalize the art colony by bringing art, providing 20 fellowships for artists and writers to come into town. The idea was to bring young people into town, hopefully they will stay, and keep the art colony alive. And I'm going to get to them, get to that next, but the Long Point Gallery was about 10 years later, Long Point Gallery was established, which was a cooperative gallery, and Robert Motherwell was central to that, group that formed the Long Point. It is where I interviewed probably most of the artists that were members, and I wanted to talk about some of them. Leo Manso, I interviewed him at the time that he was having an exhibition, 1987, here at the Art Association. He was a very interesting philosophical man, very interested in Eastern and Zen, and when we talked, I'll never forget, he said this to me, it was really funny. He enjoyed being here in Provincetown because he could walk out of his house and go behind through this garden to a studio, and he said, there he was, he didn't have to take a subway to work, and that was really great for him. He said, when I asked him about what he was trying to do with his work, he said, I'm trying to achieve some linkage with major myths which run through mankind's experience. And he said, if that sounds pretentious, I apologize. But that's the only way I know how to say it. He said, I'd rather be a poet than a reporter. And he looked at me, the reporter. And these are some of his works. He did some beautiful collages. Motherwell talked about his collages as just being, and Motherwell was a great collages. Tony Vivers, part of the Sun Gallery. He started out as an abstract expressionist, got very involved in figurative art, was a member of Long Point, and then he went full circle, came back to abstraction, using materials, well known for his sand-coated paintings and a lot of rope that he would find scavenged from the beaches in Provincetown. So that kind of represents his full circle. Sydney Simon. That piece is in the Dennis exhibition. It's a small piece, and it is part of his mirror series, where Sydney wanted to kind of introduce ambiguity into his work. He said when he came out of the service after World War II, abstract expressionism was kind of in full swing, but he said all he wanted to do was paint big fat nudes. And he did, and then he ultimately became a sculptor, and he was the one that said that Chaim Gross helped him a lot and introduced him to some of his collectors. Sydney was very funny. A number of the artists at Long Point, I found, had this very kind of dry wit, or even funnier than that, and Sydney's was you know, he did a lot of puns in his work too, but he said he was interested in telling a good story in some of his work, that's what he was trying to do, and he did a lot of big commissions. There's a piece in Philadelphia and a piece in on Sixth Avenue in New York, very large Four Seasons, big sculpture. He said he liked working with architects better than with gallery owners, because gallery owners really encourage you to repeat yourself, because if you sold well one type, you didn't want to move into anything else. But he said, I'm a maverick. If the wind blows one way, I go the other. And that was how he, a baritone Bogosian, also a member of Long Point. I interviewed him a number of times. He was a great teller of tales. He used a lot of literary references. His work had their assemblages and collages. The first time I interviewed him, he was 68 years old, and he was putting up a show at Long Point. And he was very concerned about time. He said, in 2 years, I'm going to be 70. He said, oh. He said, time flies, and time is short. And he was scurrying around the gallery like a man 35, moving some of these large pieces around. And then a photographer came to photograph him. And, he kind of looked around, and he said, well, how do you want me to pose? And he finally stretched out on the floor, and he was like this on the floor with his, he was wearing khaki shorts and a white shirt and dark socks and shoes. And he was, and it was a great photograph. And it really was very expressive of Bogosian's personality. When he teamed up with Paul Resica, there was a workshop. In 2001, Michael Mazur was doing a printmaking workshop at the Fine Arts Work Center, and a number of artists were there, and they produced prints that were then sold at auction to benefit the Fine Arts Work Center. So he, Bogosian, and Paul Resica were working on a plexiglass plate, and Resica was standing there doing his signature boats and little cottages on this plexiglass plate, and Michael was working the press, and Bert Yarber, I think, was there working the press, and Bogosian was standing behind Resica, and he said, oh no, I don't like that cottage, and so he just, Resica wiped it out, and there was some other color, and all of a sudden, all you saw were like fireworks and kind of through a mist, and then Bogosian said over Resica's shoulder, I don't even like those colors. So Resica wiped those out, and all then you saw was this mist. And they just kept doing this on, and it was like this stand-up comedy show that lightened the whole mood of the evening. Resica, I interviewed him several years later, and he said, we were talking about, a lot of his paintings are of Provincetown, we talked about why he paints what he paints, and he said, does it matter what you paint, piers and boats or forms you can do something with? You do what you can do to get you to work, to find the form. And then he said, he was kept looking for an explanation of why he paints what he paints, and he says, is it a feeling for space, or is it that you painted it as a child? It's what's out there. Where you find the spot, you can do something with. And lots of times, Resica found it in Provincetown. Again, his boats. Sometimes he got a little cubistic there. Carmen Cicero. You could talk to Carmen Cicero for hours, not only just about art, but about, he's a jazz musician, about jazz, about, and 1940s movies, which happens to be a passion of mine for whatever reason, I don't know. But anyway, I've talked to Carmen several times, and we always ended up talking about those 1940s movies. His work is, he also started out as an abstract expressionist and moved on to figurative art. And there's an enigmatic quality to his work. There's a mysterious quality. And this little guy here, Tracer of Lost Persons, you find him in several of his pieces. It kind of reminds me of, maybe it's the 40s thing, of a Humphrey Bogart in a trench coat and a hat, the way they, and striding like that. And apparently he was inspired by a radio show called Mr. Keene, Mr. Keene, Tracer of Lost Persons, that was apparently went on for years in the radio. People are shaking their head. and at the Dennis Museum, there is something called the Rysdale Enigma, which this little guy is in. And Carmen put him in a Rysdale landscape. So every once in a while, you'll find these little figures in Carmen's work. Several other Long Point artists, Sidio Frambaluti and his wife, Nora Spire. Both of them, I interviewed Sidio in the 1992, and in Wellfleet, they have a home, he and his wife, Nora, have a home on Higgins Pond. And these are, is a view of these pickerel weeds. And as we were leaving the house to go to his studio, there were these pickerel weeds. But he was going to paint them inside the studio when they were out of sight. And you know, why didn't he just set up his easel and paint them there? But no, he said he had this memory and he didn't need to see them to paint them. And he said, I mean, these artists, some of the things that they said were so insightful and wonderful. He said, most of painting is intuition. It isn't just what you see, it's all the senses. It's the wind on my arms, it's the smell of the salt air, the sounds of nature, and it's all the knowledge you've accumulated since you were a child. And when you think about painting, that's what you... when we went into the studio at the other end, there was Nora painting, and they both had their palettes were these paper plates they piled high with this thick paint. And Nora said, we're the two-man thick paint school. And you can't quite tell that on here, but they were, you could reach out and touch it. You wanted to reach out and touch it. Michael Mazur. I got to know Michael and Gail in the 90s when after they came here. This is a triptych from your time in Mashpee. Gail is sitting right here. Interviewed Gail too, she's in the book. we'll look at some more of Michael's work. This is a piece by Gilbert Franklin, which is in the collection of the Cape Cod Museum of Art and is in the exhibit. Gil Franklin and Michael were co-chairmen of the Fine Arts Work Center. Together, they worked together. Michael was in Gail, and Michael, your house is still on Commercial Street, and there's the studio is behind the house, and Michael had this beautiful view of the bay. And I thought it was kind of interesting because he said, I thought, well, these kind of watery images, I thought, oh, well, you're looking out at the bay and this is your inspiration. But he said no. He said, a painting isn't a window. It's a mirror. You're looking at yourself, which I thought was pretty interesting. And Michael also talked about change, and his work changed around the time I started interviewing him. He had started out as a figurative artist and a printmaker, and then his work became abstract. And he talked about change and how important it was for him, and how it was risky, he said, for an artist to change, something that other artists said, that because you didn't know if whatever you were going to do was going to be something worthwhile or something really good. And Michael was talking about how the change, you know, how important it was for change, and he said, for a lot of artists, fear of change causes them to imitate themselves. If you just came in the studio and did what you did yesterday and are as happy as pie about doing that, you'd have to question it, why it is that you are the same person today as you were yesterday. Did nothing happen in between? Did you experience nothing new? Was there no change in your attitude about anything? And then in the early 90s, he said that helped him deal with some of the stress that he was feeling in the studio, because he was always working toward the future instead of working in the present and the process. And he said that relieved a lot of the stress that he was feeling. And he said the biggest revelation was that he could walk away from the studio, and even if it hadn't been such a great day, he didn't have any regrets, because he figured he was going to be there tomorrow, and something would happen. And I mentioned the Fine Arts Work Center. Of course, Michael and Gail have been very involved in that. I interviewed two fellows, former fellows, Paul Bowen, who works a lot in scavenged wood. He grew up in Wales on the seaside, and when he came to Provincetown, he really felt that it felt very much like home to him, and he was very inspired by the artist. And he said, just to know that Robert Motherwell was a couple of blocks away in the summer was an inspiration. A few years ago, he was here for a number of years after his fellowship, but then he left. He's in Vermont now, but he comes back because he's a part of the Art Strand Gallery, and he still really loves to come back to Provincetown, and he teaches at the Work Center workshops in the summer. Jim Peters. I first interviewed him in 1985 when he was one of nine people on a national search that was given a show at the Guggenheim, a New Faces exhibition. And Jim was, I interviewed him outside the Fine Arts Work Center where he was working after his fellowship, and he said, he was very excited about this opening at the Guggenheim, but he said he didn't even own a suit, and he was trying to figure out what he would wear. So he found a sport coat and slacks and a white shirt and a tie, and he arrived, and he was the only artist there wearing a tie. Jim paints this very erotic art. Because he says he's very interested in the relationships between men and women, and whether it's sexual or intellectual. And he said, when I interviewed him in 1985, he said, these relationships between men and women are what propel his art. But he said, I wonder when I'm old and gray, whether I'll still want to paint these kinds of things. Well, 10 years later, I interviewed him again. He had left Provincetown, gone to New York, upstate New York, and then really missed Provincetown, came back, built a home in Truro. And I interviewed him then, and he was still doing this kind of art. And this is a relatively recent piece. So, I mean, certain things have changed, but it's always pretty gritty and erotic and sensual. He also most recently left to go to, lives in Rhode Island now, but he's still loves the town. And this kind of will tie up as we come to the present day in Provincetown. He talked about the fact that the town has become gentrified, he said, yet he's always seen it as a little piece of New York dropped into the sea. And he said the town, it's got a punk sensibility, he said. And then he said, and this is great because it kind of builds up to the conclusion, but the ocean and the dunes will always make P-Town attractive. Nothing compares to the back shore. Just to walk through the dunes, go to the ocean, just to look 210 degrees and see nothing. Just the pounding of the ocean, and just realize you're a peon. And there are all these forces here, and what do you want to do with it? Write about it, paint it, or just suck it in and go back and be a lawyer? And coming into present day, right before I finished the book, I interviewed some artists that represented the generations of artists. Tabitha Beavers and her mother, Elspeth Halverson, who was married to Tony Beavers. So Elspeth talked about, spending her childhood years here. And Tabitha talked about spending her childhood years here. Her parents had bought Mark Rothko's house in 1964. And when I went to interview them, I was sitting on the sofa, and they said, "You're sitting on Mark Rothko's sofa." So I felt like I was touching a bit of history. And Tabitha described what she would hear from her childhood bedroom when her parents would be entertaining artists and writers, and they would be singing and telling jokes and talking philosophy and art and politics. And she said, she hardly knew anybody that wasn't an artist or a writer. And where she grew up, and she said, go back to Tabitha's work. They talked about the changes in Provincetown as Jim did, but she said, when my parents' generation came here, it was a cheap escape from the city. Now it's an incredible luxury to live here. It used to be that people were coming here to enjoy the simple pleasures of nature and the beach and working in their studios and staying in some funky cold water shack. But she said it's different now. She said, talking about her work, that as she came of age as an artist in the 70s, she had the desire to take the female figure back from art history. There were very few women artists, but there were endless pictures of female nudes, she said. And I wanted to paint the female nude from a woman's point of view. And a lot of her work is sometimes pretty disturbing, obviously, when we talk about rape and you know, the points. And her mother, this is a Elspeth Lussie's boxes, and this is obviously in remembrance of the 9/11 with the Twin Towers, and Elspeth uses a lot of these horseshoe crabs, and that was obviously the planes or, you know, the destruction raining down. Two others generations are Ann Packard and her daughter Cynthia and Leslie Packard. Anne came to Provincetown in the late 70s, divorced with five children, and she didn't have a gallery, and she hung her paintings out. She was on Commercial Street, hung her paintings out on the fence, and a neighbor a few doors away would have bought a few, and she didn't know who he was, and she was on the street one day, and she was with a friend, and she said, "Oh, that gentleman's buying, has bought a few of my paintings. Who is he?" And her friend said, "Well, that's Robert Motherwell." And there couldn't have been more different. So, and she said Motherwood would come by, and he would talk and talk, and she would listen. And Anne's work is very calm, stillness and blues, very, she said, and a lot of times there are these, you know, views of the sand and the water, and sometimes she loses the horizon. Oftentimes there's a solitary boat. But she said to me, "When I paint a boat, it's not a painting of just a boat. The boat is my vehicle to get this feeling I have." And she said, "I love boats. But less is more." And I think that really says a lot about Anne's work. Less is more. And what she's after is the mood. It's the mood I seem to paint over and over. And then she said, it's solitary, it's not lonely, although some people might look at that and say it's lonely. But she said, no, it's solitary. That was the positive spin. And then Cynthia's work, very different, does a lot of very textured work, either thick with paint, and she does a lot of, these are collages, this is a collage with, I think, lace that she bought in New York, but very different than her mother's. So Provincetown, this brings us up to present day. Provincetown certainly has seen its ups and downs, as probably most of us know. But as one person told me, it's always had the courage to reinvent itself and has survived and is still an art colony. And last year, after my book was done, the National Trust for Historic Preservation and designated Provincetown home of the nation's oldest art colony. So I felt vindicated by putting all this attention on Provincetown. So thank you, and I'll be happy to answer any questions. The artist here, I hope I quoted you correctly. Don't remember. Well, I have it on tape in case you want to hear it again. Any questions? No? Good.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I'm just kind of curious about some of the artists that you said you didn't include because there wasn't time or room. Who were some of those people that you might have edges of that story?
Oh, yeah, there's so many of them. I mean, and this is only a small representation of what's in the book. There are several hundred artists mentioned in the book. I did about 70 that I, through the years, that I interviewed. I mean, people like maybe Bruce McCain, Saul Wilson, I mean, Will Barnett, I didn't interview until just by chance, because he's having a show here. I did. I wrote a piece for Art New England. So there were so many artists that Phil Malkoth is mentioned, but I never had a chance to interview him. A lot of it was because I wasn't here when they were there. Obviously, I had to do a lot of research to fill in the gaps of, you know, I didn't interview Hofmann, but I found so many of his students that were here. And was lucky enough to find somebody that had studied with Hawthorne, which took me all the way back to really the beginning. So that was great. And then I just filled in. There were so many that that we didn't. And there have been, I don't know. Someday somebody should do an encyclopedia of the artists that worked here. There's a book, and I think it's still, I know it's out of print, but I think the bookstore still has it, Provincetown Printers, which was published in the mid-70s. Which is kind of an encyclopedic kind of look at the artists that were there, and was very helpful to me in my research. It's a lot of my endnotes are Provincetown painters and Ross Moffat's book, Art in Narrow Streets. Mm-hmm.